name is Mubani Mani. Like you, I was a minority in Karachi many, many years ago. And a few words that you used just brought me back. Like Pervez Musharraf and I were contemporaries in St. Patrick's School in Karachi. And brown paper, the top of your father, brown paper. The ex-wife of Zevi Suveri was the founding editor of brown paper. She was my neighbor in Karachi. Mm-hmm. And you said you are in the breweries.
Yes.
Yeah? My last assignment in Africa was looking after the Heineken breweries in Nigeria.
Okay.
So basically, I understand what you have said is perfectly true, because it's marrying young Hindu girls in that part of the world is rampant.
It's
absolutely rampant. It's going on, and it has been unfortunately been given a sanction of not only political but religious.
Religious. That is
so. For you as a minority, to good luck to you, but it's not going to be easy to fight that.
I know that, sir.
I mean, my neighbors have tried to convert me many times. But because I didn't belong to the depressed classes, it didn't happen. And the reason why we moved to Karachi was my sister became 14 years. And so therefore we had to, you know, no way I could. Get a marriage in first the Hindu candidate to marry, the Hindu candidate, similarly Hindu candidate. And second to very risky. So when she became 14, we had to leave and leave. And basically, actually I resented it very much when I came from there to see the freedom that the minorities enjoy here.
Oh yes.
I mean, there is no way a Hindu in India, in Pakistan, if his family is wrong or anything, can take to the streets, he would be slaughtered. And here we have a situation where minority not only take to the streets, but they attack the majorities. And I think, I don't know how many people you were in Mumbai, but if you, when I was in working with Hindustan Unilever in Brabourne Stadium, we used to have cricket matches in India and Pakistan. If the stadium were very quiet, that means Pakistan was not doing very well. And if there was a four of the six, you would hear it from Bidi Bazaar to Church Gate. I don't know how many of you people in that area, I'm talking about 1967, 68.
And that situation is changing.
Changing now. But
perhaps changing already.
No, but still, not fully. If you go, I will not name the place, but I go to a hair cutting saloon where minority or the Babur community, and when you were seeing India, Pakistan, who know Jeeter hai? And the guy said, who are Jeeter if not the Indians? It's year ago. But these things happen, and you don't know. So basically, you have a really tough fight to do what you are doing, and you're going to do it. I don't know how you're going to do it. And even in the constitution, there are certain areas that are shut out to the minorities. The president, the prime minister, certain levels, 75% in the government. That must be the
clerical
staff.
Exactly.
So, good luck to you. I lost everything what you said. It's a tough fight.
So, my name is Captain Afte, and I come from the world of shipping. And I had close interaction with Pakistani friends when I was a regular visitor to the Middle East. Especially I recall my very close association with a Pakistani citizen of Parsi descent, Mr. Meenu Meenwal. He is no more in this world, but I had very close relation with him. He was a leading businessman in Dubai who represented the shipping organization for which I worked. And various issues on both sides of the border are very well known to the educated class of both sides. I don't think they need further elaboration. But I asked him then a very simple question in my continuous long cooperative interaction that I had with him. How hopeful are you, sir? I used to ask him, how hopeful are you about some light dawning up on the horizon for both societies coming together, both countries coming together, is there any genuine hope? Is there any genuine feeling of optimism? That is the question that I asked him. And he, in his advancing age, he was quite senior to me by about 10, 12 years. His reply was somewhat pessimistic. I would just like to submit that to you, sir. I mean, I listened to you very carefully. I have been a few times to Karachi, being a shipping man. And I used to meet a lot of Pakistani friends when I was visiting various parts of Middle East. And the general feeling that emerged from my interaction there was along the same lines. And I think this feeling was given an expression by none other than President Musharraf after he was left the chair, President's chair, and went to London, to the extent of saying that it is a failed state. So much as I admire people of courage like you, sir, who are taking on such very uphill tasks, or Himalayan tasks, or Hindu Kush tasks, if I may use the expression, and taking into consideration what is happening now in other parts of the Middle Eastern world, what is your own gut feelings on this subject?
Thank you. I can't do it alone. I need your wishes also, all of you. You see, in Pakistan, I would subscribe to your Mr. Meenu Marwala's feeling, though Mr. Kulkarni isn't.
Did you know him?
No, I didn't.
You heard of him?
No. Mr. Kulkarni over here, he is quite an optimist, which is good. You see, the Pakistanis and the Muslims, when they're looking at the media, especially things after 9/11, they think the Islam is under threat, Pakistan is under threat, and what I'm trying to say is that we have to look at holistically, not just from the India-Pakistan perspective of the relations. When they see Western culture set in, internet and God knows what not, so the right wing is not taking it very well, that these are all Western influences perverting our children, perverting our society. And so I think had this 9/11 fiasco not happened, and Kargil and what not, so, I'm not very optimistic about any light shining on anyone, you know. I don't know whether I should say this or not. War is also a big industry, which person sitting on my right knows more than I do. And there are certain people on both sides which would not like, you know, all hunky-dory, or not like rivers of milk flowing without going into the details of anything. So, I see a status quo I don't see India or Pakistan hugging out to each other or anything that sort. If we live peacefully enough, if we agree, even if we agree to not, you know, even if we agree to agree to disagree that, you know, so even if we do that, we are all right. You know, whenever Kashmir comes in, it just spoils everything. Whether it is commerce, what we discussed in November. So we have to talk of other things, commerce. I know this is not a government view I'm giving you, this is a very personal view I'm giving you. You know, I tell people back home ki aajkal koi ek marla ya ek canal koi nahi chhodta. How do you expect India to just vacate or leave or surrender, abdicate, you know, the valley or anything like that. So let's not talk about it. So you know, I'm giving you all these views in a personal capacity, not as a legislator. But we don't have high expectations like your foreign secretary came last week. And good when I heard from both sides say, don't have high expectations. Don't expect that the foreign secretary is here and the Kashmir is resolved the next day. So you know, don't expect much from these visits. They are good for photography and all that. But I would just say, even if we agree to disagree, that is all right. That is okay. Gentlemen.
There are certain facets of Sujinder who I've known for the last 35 years. I didn't know he was an expert on war. But if there is one person in this room,
he knows.
If there is one person in this room who is an eternal optimist, it's my good friend Sujinder Kulkarni. And he's always trying to do what is best, and all that the Observer Research Foundation is doing, not only in this sphere, but in every sphere, is so positive. So every time he just calls me, and there is no way that I can never say no to him. A very industrious person. But I have had a brief discussion with this one here, we've just met. And yes, of course, this is a matter of grave concern to us. What is happening with our neighbor? Especially as the next conflagration, the next problem that we have may not be just related and kept in control with conventional warfare. You know the situation there is. And I think the biggest threat that we today face as a country comes not internal but external and from our neighbor to the west. So I think it is very, very important that no matter what, whether in the secretary level stops, which are going to yield only photo opportunities, but there is a communication and a level of communication which is always there for. And a level of communication between reasonable people, like Mr. Bandara on the other side, Kulkarni on this side, and so many more, A, who are well-wishers. Like I was reading, I actually, and very coincidentally, came across the name of your father in a book I was reading on Ram Deshpande. And Ram Deshpande also practiced back to diplomacy with Pakistan. And the person on the other side was a gentleman called Henry Bandara. So it was very coincidental that I read that. And Ram Deshpande, of course, has deep roots in Pakistan and since in Karachi. And that's where not only was he born, of course he's now a venerable 90 plus. So not only where he was born, not only where he had his education, not only where he got his mischievous streak, which has at the age of 14, which has not left him at the age of 92. So, I think, and before this, we had a little discussion again of how the Parsi community in India and the Parsi community in Pakistan will probably have the process. There's not much chance of that happening. That's the discussion that we sort of had. The Parsi community in India is very well placed, is flourishing, not in numbers, but otherwise. And I guess that is not the same situation of the community in Pakistan, not because of anything else, but because of the law and order situation in their country. So it is not a very happy situation what is happening across our border on the other side. But if there is any way that, as, in any event, any, small a book on the subject or something of that sort, which would also be of some use to our Parsis in India who are not really aware of how much the Parsi community contributed to Pakistan and to Karachi in particular. We were discussing about Masulwanji Mehta out there, as far as Richard Kharab, you know, a lot of other people in Pakistan. So I think this is we should make this as a beginning. As far as the minorities are concerned, just one question I sort of wanted to ask you. What was the situation of minorities in terms of percentages during 1947? And what is it now? I mean, today you said about 3 to 4 or 5%. 47 is what, much more?
7.5%.
No. What is the census taken?
The declared one is 3%.
No, it's
47 is 7.5.
No, it was much more. You know, of course it was undivided Pakistan then.
Yes.
East and West.
So
and that together was about
20%. Must be much more.
Yeah, this is right because now we are talking only of West Pakistan.
I'm talking of West Pakistan. I would reckon about 7 to 8% now.
No.
The government version is 2 to 3%, which I disagree.
Because the Bengal was the new population is much higher. This put money by and together it was.
You see the government
also is discouraging or not very active on the census because there are the government. Sometimes the PPP and our government, they feel that the seats will be taken more by the MQM. The PPP will fear if there's a census. The Muhajirs from India, they will take more seats. So let's do away with census. So likewise, our government will also say the Punjabi population, if the Sindhi population exceeds the Punjabi population, then the tilt will be in the Sindh. Right now the tilt is in Punjab, where I come from. So there are political reasons for not having the, other than the administrative reasons and the financial reasons, there are political reasons also for not having the census for 15, 16 years.
So Nara, I wanted to touch on with you. I'm Siddhant, I work here at the Observer Research Foundation. I want to touch on two themes that you were talking about earlier. The first being the idea of the nation becoming synonymous with the state. That when you talk about the speech and the ability of Pakistan to be an Islamic state and also have minorities. And over time it's become more synonymous with the idea of Islam and not just minorities. And second is the idea of narrative when you talk about the textbooks in schools. So what about the minority? It's sort of a three-part question, so you have to forgive me. What about the minorities within the minority, or minorities within the majority per se? The Sufis, or the Sufi influence. There were two mosques, Sufi places of worship, Rehman Baba and Bahadur Baba, that were bombed a couple of years ago. And Sufism was considered to be one of those bridges, like you talk about bridges and you spoke to your father in that way. Sufism was supposed to be a bridge between, coming from the Rishi culture of the north, that bridge between Hinduism and Islam. Where has that progressed in Pakistan civil society beyond folk studio and the ability to listen to music that is popular. The second is the concept of narrative. When it comes to whenever there's, I mean, everyone talks about how
you
Pakistan.
You lose me.
Yes.
Go and
see, this
one. Ask one.
Okay, so how about Sufism as a bridge between?
Well, I myself am a very admirer of folk studio, but the soft Islam, that is not raising its voice. You see the Sufis, I know what you know, the Sufi Islam, the ones like they have these melas and music on their shrines, the soft version of Islam, they are not, it's a big, they're not raising their voice against the hardliners. As a minority, we can't say, we can't take sides or we can't do anything. For example, the Shias, is this one?
Hello?
For example, Shias are under prosecution. The soft Islam, the Sufi Islam is under prosecution. They are sometimes bombing shrines. In Peshawar also, they bomb the shrine of some Baba, Sayyid or someone. There's a shrine right behind the presidency.
behind the parliament, forgetting the name, that was bombed. But again, it is not for the minorities to make noise, you know, they will never make noise on the bombings of Muslim shrines. But they just keep quiet on it. They're not raising their voice against what are you doing with our religion? We as minorities cannot say that. Try to understand that. We as minorities, Parsis or Hindus or Christians, cannot go out and say that your religion is under hijack from the hardliners. What are you doing? We can't say that. But coming the Sufi thing is a good you know, khanda Muslim, as I call it. Not with hatred or vengeance and God knows what not. Not with a gun. He's with a pen or with music. But they are not coming out. They are not coming out and trying to protect their own religion, I guess. That was your last question of the Sufism.
Yeah, that was.
Yeah.
So the second thing I was asking about was narrative. There's a culture of denial and conspiracy that goes on in civil society in Pakistan, and I'd like to comment on that. Whenever there's an incident, whenever, for example, when Bin Laden was found in Abbottabad, Indians and Pakistanis are best friends abroad. I went to university, my best friends are Pakistani, and by and large, throughout, everyone said that the Americans had captured him somewhere, brought him in,
planted
him there, then killed him, and then took him out again, and left without his body. So there was no Osama Bin Laden in Pakistan. This culture of this denial, is this fed by the narrative in textbooks, or is it the internalization of the army's narrative?
No, I think the conspiracy theory is very ripe in the subcontinent. Our people like conspiracies, you know. They say that 9/11 was all a hoax. So, you know, I really don't know. Who prompted Osama? They never told me, consulted me before. I wish they had. But, you know, who planted him where, it's of no consequence to anyone now. Whether it was planted or not planted, whether 9/11 was done by Israelis, they say. Conspiracy theories are in every barber shop while he's cutting your hair. So, you know, and the minorities, in Pakistan at least, they try to be, you know, not. They try to keep their comments reserved. They will not openly say, no, the Muslim version is right or the other's version is wrong or anything that sort. So the conspiracy theories are there. They always will be on both sides. Whenever there's a blast war from it in India, actually the first I will look towards the western border, and vice versa. And even there's a conspiracy theory going on right now in Pakistan that all the ills in Balochistan,
the creation of rock.
Exactly. Finish my sentence. So, you know, so what is the real situation? No one will know. You know, who killed Kennedy? We'll never know. Who killed Benazir? Or, you know, stuff like that. And whatever they say, all the ills in Balochistan are by the border on the Eastern Front. So, you know, it's debatable.
Last question is just about minority. You as a minority legislator in the National Assembly, do you face and these sort of bills that you are pushing, which are braved by many comparisons, do you face any personal threat and
not,
issues because...
Not so far. I don't know about tomorrow. Not so far.
Hi, my name is Daltan Kirtane. I'm also with Observer Research Foundation. 1,400 Parsis is what you said is...
1,400.
That's
under 1,400.
That's like in one Rustam Park we have that many Parsis. You know, it's like so good to know how... that
we coach
So, no, I had a question for you as a Parsi and you as a Parsi as well. And it's to do with India-Iran relations. India and Iran have been very, very strong neighbors, and we've had great ties over very long periods of time. And in the recent past, with pressure from the West, US in particular, we had to forcefully sever almost that kind of tie with Iran, which is very unfortunate. But you are much closer to Iran. I think a part of why we are not close to Iran is because we can't approach them by road. You know, today we have the opportunity that people who are taking a car and a motorcycle and driving into Bhutan become crazy. Bhutan, Nepal, and that's until we reach China, then they don't let us in. Similarly, you know, it would have been a great opportunity to drive through Pakistan, and I'm sorry to be a little romantic here, but it's been great to drive through Pakistan. It's so close. The distance that bridges Iran and India is about 1,200 kilometers between Pakistan. That's like Mumbai-Bangalore. And, you know, we're denied that opportunity in some way. What about Pakistan-Iran relationships? How has that gone? And is Pakistan becoming more of an island within itself?
Okay, I'll go back to number one, Iran is Shia. And I don't need to further elaborate on that. You know, I mean, let's, if we are in the real, living in the real world, you know, Shias are being targeted in Pakistan. Real targeted. They are the most prosecuted people over there. Not the Christians, not the Hindus, not the Pashtuns. So, the romantic side can take place somewhere else, the romantic drive, like you said, not on the Iran side. Because the border with Iran is full of smugglers and gun runners. The Balochistan, the stretch, even I would feel very uncomfortable going to the Quetta city, which is right on the border. You know, it's kidnapping for ransom, you know, there's a thriving business over there. So, you know, unless I want to be kidnapped, I'll land up there. So that area is full of gun runners, terrorists, and then this is the local law and order situation. Then, as I told you, the Shia and the Sunni factor is there. And all the Parsis who go to our holy places in Iran, they just take the Dubai route and land up in Iran, do their pilgrimage. There's a lady in Karachi who does the tours. I'm sure there's many in here also. So we do that. We don't need to physically cross the border. It's very dangerous.
This Parsi has never been to Iran. And it has no inclination really to go there.
There's
nothing that we should really go there. In fact, during the last assembly elections, you know, the surprising part and the very satisfying part is that even though we don't, there may be 1,400 Zoroastrians in Pakistan, there are probably about 65,000 Zoroastrians in India.
46?
Maybe 46, whatever. Even the data census. Anyway, we are inconsequential as far as numbers go. But the government has been, you know, in the last few years have really treated us well and with respect. And there was one proposal a local MLA during the elections put up, is that they will provide subsidies for Parsis who want to go to Iran. So we are providing a Hajj subsidy. Why don't we provide subsidies for Parsis to go to Iran? And I can assure you that there won't be many takers for that subsidy. Because we are very clear that we've come here, you know, more than a century ago, 1300 years ago. This is our country. This is now Janma Bhumi, Karma Bhumi. This is the Bhumi that we have. We have more affinity to India and Hindus than we have to Kenya and Iran. Right? So for us, yes, there is a certain part of our community, which are the Irani Zoroastrians, who have come much later. And those Irani Zoroastrians do have connections, including land, property and all, in Iran. That is a different thing altogether. You know, for them that is their vatan because they've been here for about 100 years. And they have completely also assimilated as far as, so we are now Parsi, Irani, Zoroastrians. And as far as the geopolitics are concerned, now that is a separate issue, but it doesn't really bother us Parsis in India. His house here was called Quetta Terrace, and another aside was that his cousin, who was in fact brought up by Ushikanandan Mother Thelema, his cousin was Gaura Patel, who was the judge, and who was the judge of the Supreme Court of Pakistan, and he was the only judge who held for Zulfikar Ali Bhutto in Bhutto's trial.
जो चीजें मैं ऑब्जर्वर रिसर्च फाउंडेशन में काम कर रहा हूँ और अभी जो आपने जितनी भी चीजें बताई उसके बाद फॉर अ कॉमन मैन एंड ऑल्सो फॉर अ कॉमन वुमन इन पाकिस्तान व्हाट इज द रियल मीनिंग ऑफ फ्रीडम एंड हाउ मच दे आर एक्चुअली एंजॉयिंग द फ्रीडम
फ्रीडम इज देयर बट इट्स वेरी मच इन लिमिटेशंस यस्टरडे नाइट आई वाज ट्रैवलिंग फ्रॉम Bandra to my hotel, I saw a girl with earphones sleeping behind a taxi, and taxi when I was going. So I just thought to myself, this was something big for me. 11 o'clock girl sitting at the back. But girl can also sit at the back over there also, but not at 11 with such ease. So freedoms are there, but it has some limitation to it. Girls do sit in taxis over there also with the thing in their ears, but not at 11 o'clock at night or 11:30 it was, when I think I dropped you, auntie. So these are things, you know, these are things, freedoms are there, but of course with the females, that restriction is more limited, going out families, and you have to remember, these limitations are not set by the government or by law and order situation or anything that sort. These restrictions are also in the religion. You know, see, it's an Islamic state, and the freedoms for girls not to wear jeans, not to go out partying or having boyfriends, etc., etc. This is not done due to any political or any, nothing to do with terrorism or anything that sort. It is in their own belief. So, you know, so if the girl is not wearing jeans, don't take it as she doesn't have the freedom. She doesn't want to wear jeans. That's it. Freedom is not a problem.
Yes, my name is Hansa. I also work here at Observer Research Foundation. A couple of months back, we had cooperated with George Washington University to host a conference called Women in Water, which is a peace-building activity across five nations, India, Pakistan, Tajikistan, Kyrgyzstan, and Afghanistan. And amongst all the women who were represented in the forum were women who were working on water, which means they were fighting all odds of social, cultural, and political hurdles to be able to bring in water security in dry areas of all these countries. And this was sort of like a peer-to-peer exchange, so sort of things that worked for some somebody in a dry land in India could be adopted in Afghanistan or in Pakistan. That was like a very quick sort of like a classroom exercise where we went out on the field as well. The women from Pakistan had done something very, very interesting. I'd like to share that with all of you. Was to create steps next to a bank of a river so that women wouldn't slip down and fall. For me, that's freedom as well. For you to be able to bring in that kind of security to someone. And that was very refreshing to see. But it also goes to show how much of minority women, while women being in the minority gender as it is, are even in that, some of them come from minority religion or minority status in society. They are also able to. Would you want to share some of the work that you would probably have come across, something that
the
you
work, could have? The work of women.
Yeah, coming from minority sections.
Well, you got me there. I'll have to think about it and give you my. I can't answer you right now. Because to be very honest, I've never come across a sitting where a woman, I know what you're trying to say, empowerment or some of women, I'll have to come back to you.
Can I ask a question? Sorry. This is not really about minorities, but just about relation between India and China, or India and Pakistan. On 22nd of February, just a few days ago, just a month ago, India finally formed a company which would allow India to build ports overseas. And the first port formally decided was the port of Chabahar, which is next to
Iran.
Which is next to Gwadar, where China is building a port.
And Jebel Ali.
Yes. What India has also done is India has strategically built a 900-kilometer railway line going straight from Chabahar into the mineral-rich areas of Afghanistan. So obviously, it's geopolitics. But the first stone was cast when Chabahar was taken up, or when Gwadar was taken up. India has possibly no other alternative but to take up Chabahar more aggressively. So you have a situation where both of them are entering into alliances, Pakistan and Iran, with China and India. Do you think that is going to worsen relations, or do you think that's going to bring in some stability and sense between the two countries?
Well, I would like Mr. Kulkarni to answer that question.
Only very answer. Your take.
Questions
or
basic
points.
Sir, you referred in your brief address, as well as just now very passingly, about the fact that war itself is an industry. And just now you explained about the ground reality of gun running across the border region country where you may not want to go out. My question is related to both of you, sir. Why is the world of journalism completely silent on the statistical details of sale and purchase of arms, considering what is happening in Syria and Iraq and many other places in the world? I mean, we have our defense budget, the figures come out on the floor of the parliament, and the figures are made available to the entire public. But I find the world press and the world of journalism very conveniently silent on the statistical figures of the production of arms around this world.
Yes, your point is well received, but I would just like to add on to Mr. Kulkarni was saying whether it is Afghanistan. Pakistan would never like a strong India in Afghanistan. Let's face it. So the more India will go, they might build whatever bridges, dams, at the end of the day, it will create more instability in that region. So this is the fact, we have to live with. The less India is in Afghanistan, the more things will be calmer. Whenever we hear that this all the time, why has India made 17 or 18 consulates in a place like Kandahar where there is no business, no human being? So naturally the argument that the counter narrative is that, oh look, you see this is what they are doing, these are their bases to stir problems in Balochistan. So geographically, Pakistan and Afghanistan share a big boundary like they do, but the more India is seen in Afghanistan, I think more instability will come.
I just want to make one point here which brings me to this book. This book is about the Kailash tribe. In an area which is part of Pakistan, but just across the border is not very far, is the Nuristan, which is in Afghanistan.
Yes, yeah.
And Nuristan was earlier called Kafiristan, which after some political developments and conversion, they call it Nuristan. Place of light. If we go into history, it's a struggle between religious traditions that have emphasized tolerance, coexistence, and traditions that have emphasized conquest. And that is again playing out now. Not just with players within the region, but many people coming from both sides, whether it's the Soviet Union or the United States. So which is why Asia has to rise, and this part of Asia, South Asia, has to rise, and we have to rise in a way that we recover our cultural spiritual past. Otherwise, we are doomed. Will there be more and more extremism, more violence, and more suppression of minorities, and more minorities are suppressed in Pakistan? It will have its repercussions in India. For example, what you mentioned just now of Hindu girls being converted and married off. That has a narrative of love jihad in India. So, we have to really look at South Asia as a whole, and that was the reason why we looked at people's SAARC. That people, and not just governments, and not just diplomats, and not just politicians, but people must come forward and rediscover our bonds and
strengthen those bonds.
And one comment to that. Remember we discussed in Delhi, I remember, we discussed my take was on the business, and my first point was this visa regime on both sides. It's very rigid. So, somehow, the business community can do away with visa, the people going through their religious, places of worship. Parsi should not need a visa to go to Rwanda, stuff like that. So I think both countries need to have a visa is the biggest hurdle also. And we don't get TV channels, TV channels don't come into ours and vice versa. So these are also the soft,
it is so very unnatural. We have a poster here, Mumbai at Karachi. A close bond in the past, a closer bond in the future of progress. The second part is optimism. Nothing funny to say. But just look at the past. These two iconic buildings in Mumbai and Karachi, the architect, the engineers were the same. And today, we have a situation where there is no direct flight between Mumbai and Karachi. No. There is no direct flight between Mumbai and Karachi now.
It was experimented. I'm supposed to fly down on the day after tomorrow.
When I last year, come on there.
It not started for him.
But point is, you see, India, Mumbai and Karachi were so close.
Yes.
Just five hours by ship.
By ship. Yes. 1 hour by flight.
And today it's so difficult to get visas for Indians to go to Karachi.
City, you can't go to another city if it doesn't have a
city. So, we are living in a situation with so many irrational divisions, and which we seem to defend and rationalize in the name of nationalism and national pride and national security. To some extent, yes, but we have to now go beyond this. You can't be prisoners of the past.
And we on that note call it a day. Look to the future.
I want to take this opportunity to once again reiterate a thought I had. We both belong to the Parsi community in Pakistan and even India. Why don't we and the Observer Research Foundation be pleased to participate in this effort? Why don't we take up some studies of how two communities, which actually belong to one community, have been a bond of friendship and can be a bond of friendship, even though another is brutal. But recreating that past has so value in my opinion, and therefore I strongly feel that we should pursue a project which will yield something like this. And do you have any thoughts on this?
We've had this discussion before we sort of started this for the Parsis of India. As I said, there is a lot of connections between the Parsis of India and the Parsis, especially from the land. Because you mentioned where they came from. But there has been a lot of connections. And I was telling you that in Pakistan, what has unfortunately happened is that the majority of their population has migrated abroad. Right. And we organized this World Horizon Congress about 2 years ago out here, and we know the difficulties in Pakistani, naturalized Pakistani-born Parsis. Even though they were now U.S. citizens, they had difficulty in coming to
Indian.
Because they were born in
Pakistan. Because they were born in Pakistan. Of course, we could work together to do it. But, you know, there's absolutely no harm in sitting across. But, yeah, but the larger picture is this, that, you know, this is not a project meant only for the Parsis of India and Pakistan. This is a project meant to build a bridge between
India and Pakistan.
To build a bridge between India and Pakistan. And I think more important to us in India would be the contribution of Parsis in Pakistan and Karachi to that country. That will help us understand, you know, Pakistan in a sense better. Whereas the Pakistan, the Parsis in Pakistan, they in a sense have a lot of connections with India. You know, they have a lot of connections with India, but there are very few Parsis who have any sort of a connection as far as Pakistan is concerned. So maybe, yes, we will also discuss it with some people in India who have, you know, who were born in Karachi, that was pre-independence and everything was one period that was India. It can be discussed, and we will certainly take your guidance. But I think the important part is, what does Mr. Mandala feel about this? For us, it's an easy thing to do.
Just one hurdle in this. The 1400 that I mentioned, I think 70% are senior citizens who have, you know, talking to them about India-Pakistan relation. It's, you know,
it's a closed file.
No, it's not a
closed mind.
It's not a closed mind.
I said closed file.
I said exactly. Exactly. Going up, talking to a senior citizen from Parsi who has not left his compound for decades and talking to him about relations with India and Pakistan is something not his or her inner mind also. You know, so it's a hard sell.
Even though it's a hard sell, people who migrated to the United States, elsewhere, Canada, they have memories. And all these memories need to be captured.
There's one thing I must say once again about my friendship in Canada, again, as a compliment. There isn't anything which he starts and leaves. He wants to see and take everything to its final conclusion. So he's just not satisfied with the interaction which we've had today. He wants to see whether it is possible or not. And it's a good thing, again, it's a compliment, that he is always thinking about what more can be said. What more can be. So he's the eternal optimist. Whereas sometimes I feel that it is time that, you know, we move on to other things. Thank you.
Okay, before we applaud, we have something for our dear friend. Thank you, sir.
It's just a passing reference to
Nuristan.
It was telling you the proximity.